أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. أما بعد, we talk tonight, inshallah, about the five stages of life that the human being undergoes. And that starts, of course, with the first stage. We can hardly remember any of it, but the fitrah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرُّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ. At the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created Adam alayhi salam and has decreed a soul be blown into his body, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wiped on his back and he has shown him all of his dhurriya, his offsprings, means everyone who is going to live until judgment day. The good and the bad, the believer and the disbeliever, the monotheistic and the mushrik. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he shown Adam his dhurriya, Adam alayhi salam would look to his right and he would see those who are destined for paradise and he would laugh and smile out of joy and happiness. And he would look to his left and he will see those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined to the hellfire and he would begin to weep and cry in sadness over them. So here in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when he wiped on the back of Adam alayhi salam and he showed him all of his offspring, and then he asked all of them collectively, all of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the offsprings of Adam, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ aren't I your Lord? قَالُوا بَلَىٰ. They said affirmatively, they've confirmed the answer, yes, you are our Lord. قالوا بلى أن تقولوا إنا كنا عن هذا أن تقولوا يوم القيامة إنا كنا عن هذا غافلين. That you would use the excuse that you have found your forefathers, you know, have gone astray worshipping the idols or any other entity along with or aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that you would say we are unaware of the fact that you are our Lord. أو تقولوا إنما أشرك آباؤنا من قبل, or that you would say that our forefathers have committed shirk before and we were offsprings following their footsteps, indicating that this type of excuse or this type of reasoning would be unacceptable on Judgment Day. However, we as humans cannot really remember this covenant that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken from us in the Adam world. In other words, this is thousands of years ago before any of us came into existence in this form. So this was the first phase of five of our creation. The second one is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that we be born. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in the hadith, إِنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ يُجْمَعُ خَلْقُهُ فِي بَطْنِ أُمِّهِ أَرْبَعِينَ يَوْمًا نُطْفَةً. That one of you is gathered, his creation or her creation is gathered in the womb of his or her mother for 40 days. نُطْفَة means a clot of a blood. ثُمَّ يَكُونُ عَلَقَةً مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ. Then he or she will turn into alaqa, that which clings to part of the womb. ثُمَّ يَكُونُ مُضْغَةً مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ. Then he or she will turn into a mudgha, which is the size of a mouthful, looking like something that's, you know, a bite of food that's been chewed. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ثُمَّ يُرْسِلُ اللَّهُ الْمَلَكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send an angel. فَيَقُولْ اُكْتُبْ. He would say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, write the four things. The ajal, the lifespan of this person. The amal, the deeds that this person shall do. The rizq, the sustenance that this person shall receive. And then, asa'idun am shaqi, happy or miserable, meaning that happy in terms of an iman perspective. Means that is this the person who's going to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his prophets and the six pillars of iman, al-imanu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi واليوم الآخر والقضاء خيره وشره. Believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his books, divine revelations, in the authentic form, in the original form, without being adulterated, in the angels, in the prophets and the messengers, in the day of judgment, and in the predestination and preordination. So these are the ones who believe in that decree or that aqeedah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us, and perform the pillars of Islam. الشهادة, شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله, proclaiming that which is held in deep conviction in the heart, uttered by the tongue, and affirmed by the actions, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one and the only one that is rightfully worshipped, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one and the only one that is rightfully followed. Fulfilling the conditions of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, which we'll touch upon that briefly inshaAllah. And then establishing the salah, establishing the zakah, and fasting the month of Ramadan, and last but not least, performing the pilgrimage at least once in a lifetime to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Mecca for those who have the means, the ability in terms of health and accessibility to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perform, you know, the pillar of Hajj, and of course perfect their deeds, worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if they see Him, and if they cannot achieve that level of perfection, they would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knowing that He sees them with that level of perfection. So this is the creed which will make, and the deeds that will make one happy, and doing anything contrary to that, or exiting the state of Islam, or not accepting Islam altogether, this will not be accepted from a person as a valid reason for their disbelief, and they shall be among those who are miserable, wa'iyadu billah. So this is the beginning of the creation. In fact, the creation of the human being begins before that. And we mentioned one of the lataif, how the creation actually begins before the creation is gathered inside the womb of the mother. A man and a woman who were getting a divorce at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu arda'ah, they came to him and they said, "Oh Umar, Amir al-Mu'mineen," the man said, "I am rightfully entitled to custody of these children." They only had one child actually. I'm rightfully entitled to the custody of this child. And the woman, she said, "No, I am the one who's rightfully entitled to the custody of this child." So the man's argument, he said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, hamaltuhu awwalan wa wada'tuhu awwalan." He's referring to the sperm, which is the life that really present in the back of the man before even the child is conceived. He said, "I've carried it first and I've placed it first." She said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, hamalahu khafifa." He has carried it very light. "Wa wada'ahu shahwa," and he has placed it as a matter of desire. "Wa hamaltuhu thaqila," I have carried this baby for 9 months, very heavy, agony upon agony, and I've delivered it in agony. "Wa wada'tuhu kurha," and I have placed this child, I've delivered this child, you know, in utmost hardship. So everyone presented their argument. The point here is that the life of this fetus is present in the back of the man and in the egg of the woman prior to, you know, this conception inside the womb of the mother. So therefore the life is present there, then it's conceived inside the mother's womb, then it's delivered, and that is the beginning of life, which is the second phase of the life of the human being. In it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commissioned us to believe in Him and to worship Him and to submit to Him and to declare the shahada of la ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, and we'll touch upon what that means in the general sense of the word. The conditions that must be met when one declares the shahada that none is rightfully worshipped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to understand what that means. To understand what that means and to understand what it entails as well. Meaning that if one is to give their testimony of la ilaha illallah without understanding, the scholars say that they are given a false testimony. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورِ, and those who do not give false testimony. So therefore, if you want to give testimony for or against anything, you must have full knowledge and understanding what that means. So therefore, we must have full knowledge and understanding of what la ilaha illallah means. Meaning that none is rightfully worshipped by Allah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He's the one and the only creator and the sustainer and the cherisher of this universe. He's the one who brought us into existence for this very purpose. As He says in the Quran, "Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawatin wa min al-ardi mithlahun yatanazzalu al-amru baynahun lit'alamu anna Allah 'ala kulli shay'in qadir wa anna Allah qad ahata bi kulli shay'in 'ilma." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who's created the seven heavens and like them from earth, seven layers of earth. يَتَنَزَّلُ الْأَمْرُ بَيْنَهُمْ, meaning that Jibreel alayhi salam, the trustee of the heavens, descend with the revelations upon the respective prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, finalizing that and sealing that with the seal of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the message of the Qur'an, the one and the only one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, we are the ones who have descended this dhikr,
this Quran, and we are the ones who have the obligation and the responsibility to maintain it. And this is an integral, you know, part of our faith as Muslims, that this Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is an eternally living miracle that cannot be adulterated, in spite of the many, many attempts to falsify and to change and to alter and to adulterate, you know, this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we believe that this is the Quran, the complete system of guidance, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken these words and have descended these words to us for us to worship Him. So this is the first element of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that none is rightfully worshipped but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because none has created the heavens and the earth but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is that we submit to Him unconditionally. We submit to everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has descended upon us, which is the Quran and the Sunnah. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Utitu al-Quran wa mithluhu ma'ah," I was given the Quran and like it with it. So as an integral part of our faith is to believe in the Quran and in the Sunnah, that they go hand in hand and they explain one another and they cannot be separated. We cannot just believe in the Quran or just believe in the Sunnah. We believe in all of them together as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us. So the second part is to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all that He has revealed unconditionally, and to apply as we learn. وَأُوحِيَ لَيَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ لِيُنْذِرَكُمْ بِهِ وَمَنْ بَلَغْ, that this Qur'an was revealed to me to give you warning with it, to teach you the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to teach you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects of you, how to worship Him, how to learn about Him, how to come close to Him by way of establishing the fara'id, all acts of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to do in Islam, and all acts of iman that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to accept and to believe in and to submit in, that which we understand and that which we do not understand. So it's not a condition that we must understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to accept it and believe in it. And also it is not for us to be choosy, to choose some to apply and some not to apply, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran and many other places repeatedly, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ادْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةً. All you who believe, embrace Islam at large, all of it, every pillar of it, everything that you learn about Islam, be it that which is obligatory for you to attain, or the nawafil as an extra way or an additional act of ibadat to come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or be it acts of prohibitions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands to stay away from, or be it that which is halal and that which is haram. And is an integral part of this kalima of tawheed, that al-halal ma ahallahu Allah wa rasuluh, wal-haram ma harramahu Allah wa rasuluh. That which is permissible for us to attain is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made permissible. And that which is forbidden for us to attain or to engage in is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has made prohibited for us to attain, and command us to stay away from it, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ, to Him belongs the creation, and therefore to Him belongs every legislation that He descends for us to apply and to use as a system of guidance. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns those who try to take that place and to override the sharia and the legislation that is mentioned in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says, أَمْ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ, or perhaps they have legislated for them as a matter of deen what that in that or that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not permitted for it to be legislated. And as He says also in other ayat, that it is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, descended the sustenance upon you. فَجَعَلْتُمْ مِنْهُ حَلَالًا وَحَرَامًا. This sustenance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended upon us, some of the mushrikeen has made part of it halal according to their whims and desires and their way of thinking and their opinions, and that they have made similarly that which is haram according to that which they believed, or in their opinion, you know, believe that is haram. Also a condition of La ilaha illallah is to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ, and those who truly believers, أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ, they're more intense in their love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they're willing to sacrifice themselves and their wealth and their families and their children and everything on the face of the earth for the sake of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this relationship between the believers and Him, يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَ, that He loves them and they love Him. Similarly, as a condition of La ilaha illallah is that we have this yaqeen, in believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we put our trust in Him and we do حق التوكل على الله. A brief definition of توكل: صدق الاعتماد, صدق اعتماد القلب على الله في جلب المصالح ودفع المفاسد. It is the deep conviction and the truthfulness of the heart. And notice here, the scholars refer to the heart, the place of the iman. في الاعتماد على الله, that we rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that He is the one and the only one that can bring about benefits, worldly and hereafter benefits. And He's the one and the only one that can deter harm from us, here in this dunya, and also in the hereafter. So we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such deep conviction that it negates any shubha, any false belief, any misunderstanding of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be it Him as a Rabb, the creator and the sustainer of this universe, be it Him as the Ilah, the one and the only one that is rightfully worshipped, be it Him as the one with the beautiful names and divine attributes, without, with the conditions that we believe in these divine names and attributes, دون تأويل أو تمثيل أو تشبيه أو تعطيل. We accept and believe in all the divine names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as they are mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah. دون تمثيل, without drawing analogies, without raising our hands or our fingers when we talk about the hands and the fingers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أو تعطيل, or without negating the quality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has affirmed to Himself. As He says, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, He's the all-hear, the all-seer. So we cannot say He's the all-seer but cannot see, or the all-hear but cannot hear. أَوْ تَأْوِيلُ, we cannot interpret as to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears, or sees, or presides upon the throne, or descends, as He confirms in the hadith, in hadith al-Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends in the third part of the night, and He asks these three questions, هَلْ مِنْ تائب فأتوب عليه وهل من مستغفر فأغفر له. Is there one who is asking for repentance and I shall grant that to him? Is there one who is asking for forgiveness and I shall grant that to him? Is there one who is asking for a need or a necessity they may have and I shall fulfill that for him? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends دون تدني أو تنقل, meaning that without movement and without lowering Himself. We believe in that even though the mind cannot comprehend it. We stop where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to stop, from going beyond the limits of this mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us. So these are just a few of the conditions of La ilaha illallah. Now we come to the conditions of Muhammadun Rasulullah, meaning that La matbu'a bihaqqin illa Rasul. None is rightfully followed but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. None is rightfully taking the guidance from and believing that this guidance is the best of guidance that to ever, you know, be revealed to mankind, but the guidance and the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a form or shape that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not permit us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that form or shape. لتعزروه وتوقروه, to respect him and to obey him in everything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has come with, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do so in many places in the Quran. قل أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول, obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala infinitely and obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam infinitely. يا الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم, or you who believe, أطيعوا الله, obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unconditionally, and obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam unconditionally, and then obey أولي الأمر, those who attend to your affairs, your leaders, so long that they are in obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the obedience of أولي الأمر, our leaders, our caretakers, that obedience is finite and limited and conditional upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also to love and to defend the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in any form or shape that we can. To love him more than we love ourselves. As you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us in the hadith, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده ووالديه والناس أجمعين. None of you shall become a believer until I am more loved to him than his father and his child and all of mankind, all of humanity. So loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a must upon us. النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ, he is certainly has far more authority over us, and he knows best, you know, what's best for us more than we know it for ourselves. So those who adhere to the conditions adhere to La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, its conditions and its implications, all that it entails, and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in utmost humility and love, in utmost sincerity, with the intention of to evade and to escape His wrath and to enter His paradise. Those are the ones who are destined to this happiness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about in this dunya and in the hereafter. Those who violate the sharia, those who reject the message of Islam, those who reject La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, those shall live a state of drunk, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. That whoever turns away from this remembrance, and from this guidance, and from this prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent as a mercy to mankind, shall live a very constricted life. In spite of the openness of the material world to them, they are likely to live in a state of dunk, in a state of constriction, that they feel depression, if you will, high levels of stress, dunk inside of their chests, that it makes them very unhappy, but rather miserable in this life. And in the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect them and fling them upon their faces in the hellfire, wherein they neither live or die. In that case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَحْشُرُهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. They'll be in a state of blindness, they cannot see. And they will say, Oh Allah, قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا. Oh Allah, why did you resurrect me as a blind person and I was able to see in this dunya? قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتِي فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. Thus, our ayat, our clear and convincing evidence, the fitrah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created upon, the prophets and the messengers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to you, the revelations, the guidance that He has given you, you have turned a blind eye to it, and you have turned a blind heart to it. So therefore today, you shall live for eternity in a place that is extremely miserable in the hellfire, wa'iyadha billah, in a state of blindness, wa'iyadha billah. So this second phase of life is concluded when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees that the soul be removed from the body of the human being. And as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent His creed, sent His ideology of monotheistic religion, which addresses the mind, which deals with the mind, and sends His pillars of Islam, which is the actionable items of Islam that deals with the body and purifies the body in terms of salah and siyam and hajj and rest of the deeds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us that spirit which we don't know much about, as He says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. And they ask you about the soul. Say, the soul is of the knowledge that is only privy to my Lord, and we have not given you from knowledge but very little. When that soul part ways with the body, that's the moment when we transit from this dunya into another world, from this life into another life. And that's, if any of you have witnessed a person doing ihtidar, when the soul is parting ways with the body, that this person, no matter what he tried to speak to them or communicate with them, they're in a different world, and you think that they're hallucinating. In reality, it's the veil that's been revealed from their eyes. And now they're able to see the hereafter, and they're able to witness the angels, and they're able to witness the openness of the heavens, and so on and so forth. And they're in a way that they're turning away from this dunya, meaning that their journey has ended, and now it's time to descend from this world into another world. At that moment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says with respect to the believers, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause you to hold steadfast on that next journey that you're about to undertake, where He sends the angel of death to take the soul. And the soul of the believer, as we know, comes like a dough dropping off, that little water drop that falls off of a leaf into the ground in such a smooth way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His utmost and infinite mercy, allows this angel of death to take it away from the body of the believer. And rest of the angels of mercy are waiting, that they would not allow the angel of death to hold on to the soul after they extract it from the body, but for a very brief moment they take it, they shroud it from a shroud from paradise and ascend from paradise, and then the soul ascends to the heaven. And as we witness, people who are going through this phase of ihtidar, where the soul is parting ways with the body, and they're actually the basar, the vision, is able to follow the soul to see where it's ascended to. And then of course the gates of heavens are open for it, and the malaika, the angels, are praising it. And then it goes to the, you know, to the Arsh, to the throne of Ar-Rahman, and it makes sujood there. And this is an indication that one cannot come any closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya except in a state of sujood. And this is the sujood that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to increase of, to come close to Him, as we are in the closest position that we can be in this dunya to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a state of sujood. And this is the first thing that the soul does as it parts ways with the body. It goes under the throne and it prostrates itself to its creator. Then, of course, the soul travels through the, you know, paradise, and it sees its place in paradise, and then it descends into the grave as the two angels, Munkar and Nakir, come to ask the three questions: who is your Lord, and what is your deen, and what do you say in the man that was sent to you? This is the words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. That He's the one who caused the believers to hold steadfast in this dunya, and on the day of judgment. Meaning that the first part of the akhirah is when we descend into our graves. So when the angels, Munkar and Nakir, begin their questioning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is to grant us, inshaAllah, the success to answer these three questions successfully. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by way of His mercy, allows all of our deeds to surround us and protect us from these two angels. And then, of course, what comes after that is much easier. And the story is completely opposite for the disbelievers, wa'iyadu billah. So this is the life of the barzakh. This is the life of the barzakh, which is the third phase of the human life. And if we notice that the first phase is a very long one, it's been like thousands of years ago that we've existed in the form of atoms. In this life, we live barely a few decades, at best. 100 years, maybe a little bit more, a little bit less. So it's a very short journey, but this journey makes the final determination for you where you're going to live for eternity. So the time we spend in the third phase, which is al-barzakh, in the grave, that's also a far greater period than this second period that we live in now. The fourth period, of course, is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. On the day when everybody rises to the Lord of all the worlds, where everybody recognizes that this is our Lord. The believer and the disbeliever, of course, nobody's going to benefit from that except those who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who followed the book of guidance and who submitted to Him in this dunya. Those are the ones who are going to be happy with the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On that day, everybody will rise standing, naked, as was described in the hadith that's narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, when she says, O Prophet of Allah, men and women are going to be naked, standing next to one another and looking at one another. He said, Ya Aisha, this is not a time where people look at each other. This is a time of utmost difficulty. This is a time of utmost hardship, where the sun draws so near to the heads of everyone that some of them will be drowning in their sweat. Some will be up to their feet, and some up to their knees, and some up to their waist, and some up to their chest. And everybody's looking at their place in Jannah or in the Hellfire, al-Iyadu billah. This is not a time where people look at each other. So this is the time where everybody stands to be reckoned in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for those who are happy, they shall be driven into groups over the Sirat at the speed of light, or at the speed of a running horse, or at the speed of a running person or a walking person, until they reach their destination, wherein they spend an eternity, a life of eternity, in a beautiful place, in a place that's unimaginable, in a place that cannot be described. In spite of the fact the Prophet ﷺ had seen this place when he ascended to the heavens, he could not describe it. He said, "Fiha," in it, where an eye has never seen, an ear has ever heard, even the imagination of a human being ever reached. In it, where we see the blessed face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In it, where we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself. In it, where we swear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given us anything better than allowing us to see Him in paradise. This is the final phase for the believers, which is an eternal life that never ends. An eternal life that never ends. This is the fifth and the last phase. وَلَعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. The story is completely different for the disbelievers, as they will dwell for eternity in the hellfire at the different levels with different intensities and colors of punishment, where they wish at that point, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reckons even among, the beasts and the prey, and then He turns them into dust, The kafir would say, Ya laytani kuntu turaba. The disbeliever would say, I wish I was dust like these animals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has turned them into dust, as you know, he reckoned among them. Talk briefly just about what's in the hellfire, layyadu billah. And I'm not going to talk about actually what's in the hellfire, but rather how the disbelievers believe, who are destined to, you know, dwell for eternity in the hellfire. First, they would ask the angels, ادعوا ربكم يخفف عنا يوما من العذاب. Call unto you, Lord, so he could just lessen part of, you know, the punishment, just for one day, for one time period, just for one day. قالوا أولم تكن تأتيكم رسلكم بالبينات قالوا بلى. Said, didn't your messengers come to you with the, يعني with the warning and with the guidance? قالوا بلى. They said yes. قالوا فادعوا. Supplicate. وما دعاء الكافرين إلا في ضلال. And of course, their dua, their supplication is not going anywhere. So they reach such a level of desperation, and they would say, we have no resort but Malik. Malik is the trustee of the entire hellfire, والعياذ بالله. So, وقالوا يا ما ونادوا يا مالك ليقضي علينا ربك. So now they've reached such a high level of desperation, and they're calling on to Malik. In one narration, they call on him for 40 years. In one narration, another narration, they call on him for 1,000 years. For what? For mercy? No. They just want to be destroyed. Then the answer comes to them years and years later. إنكم ماكثون. Indeed, you shall spend eternity in it. At that point, the level of desperation reaches very close to 100%. But they will have one more hope, and that is to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed in the preserved tablet, you know, prior to Lawh al-Mahfuz, prior to the creation of the heavens and the earth with 50,000 years, that he shall not look at them. Where he says in the Quran, لا ينظر إليهم ولا يكلمهم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should not even look at them or speak to them. And the scholars say, had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that he looks at them, his mercy would have overtaken them. But he decreed in the preserved tablet that he should not, you know, look at them or speak to them. That he should not look at them. So they would say, they would call unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he would say, اخسأوا ولا تكلمون. اخسأوا means be miserable in it and do not speak. Indeed, a part of my ibad, my slaves, they used to supplicate on to me, and they used to, you know, pray to me, and they used to, you know, render all acts of worship for me and ask for mercy day and night. And it's not possible that I would, it's not conceivable that I would equate them, you know, with you, as he says in Surah Noon, أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ. That is it possible to equate the believers with the disbelievers? So this short period of test, it really is a short period. And just to give a conception, to get an idea of how short it is, it's like a short journey. You're going for Hajj, and you have a visa for a week or two, whatever the case might be. You perform your rituals and you come back. This dunya is really a number of stops. You know, you go through your schooling, you go through your work, through your retirement, through your ibadat, and at the end you find, where did all this time go? Of course, the wise person is the one who really invested that time, realizing how short this journey is and how crucial this journey is, that in spite of its briefness and how short it is, it determines your eternal life. In what rank you're going to be, in what place you're going to be. The Prophet ﷺ described even the ranks among the believers, that it's not just a matter of entering paradise. That one level to another is like looking at a star in the sky. That's the vast distance between one believer and the next. So this is a time where one ought to spend every moment that they can. Be it worldly matters with the purity of intention that they donate fi sabilillah, or be it religious matters to purify that ibadah and to purify that intention and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with utmost happiness that He has guided you to Islam, that He has guided us to Islam. I just, yani, walillah alhamdu wal minna, I'll conclude with this one short story. It helps us appreciate what we've inherited from our fathers and our forefathers, which is Islam. This young man who has been, you know, contemplating the idea of embracing Islam, he's been learning about Islam. He's only 22 years old. That was at the ISF in Frederick just last Friday, you know, 2 days ago. And then I sat with him. I said, you seem to be rather convinced. Something is holding you back. What is it? He said, I'm afraid that if I don't learn enough and I become a Muslim, I'm going to make a lot of mistakes. That's a concern of a 22-year-old. I said, well, you shouldn't be that concerned, because even if you've been a Muslim for 60 years and 100 years, you're still going to make mistakes. And the Prophet ﷺ says, كُلُّ بْنِ آدَمْ خَطَّاءُ وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. All of the children of Adam make mistakes, and you're not an exception to the rule. Okay? And the best of those who make mistakes are those who come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repentant. What is the benefit of that? In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, لَوْلَا أَنَّكُمْ تُخْطِئُونَ. Had you not committed mistakes and errors, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have taken you away. And he brought another people who would commit mistakes and make errors and then ask for forgiveness, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. So therefore, you're holding back from embracing Islam because Satan is playing some of his tricks on you. He does not want you to become a Muslim. So therefore, even if you study Islam for 100 years and then you become a Muslim, you're still going to make mistakes. And when you make these mistakes, you're going to feel a sense of indebtedness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're going to feel more humble towards Him, and you're going to love Him more that He's forgiven you and accepting you over and over and over again. So therefore now, you're going to be able to perform your ibadah with utmost love and utmost humility. And these are the two conditions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to offer your ibadah. Alhamdulillah, that was about 3:30 in the afternoon. He said, I'll be there 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock after Salat al-Asr, he came and he declared his jihad and became Muslim. He was so extremely overjoyed and happy that he became a Muslim. So this, like, when I look in faces like that who just embrace Islam, I look at our faces, why aren't we always happy that we are Muslims? Why aren't we always happy? Sometimes we're like, yes, it's perfectly okay to be sad every now and then, not knowing if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take your soul in a state of faith or not. Huh? But that is a marginal and a slim possibility, right? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we see that the opposite happened. People live a life of mischief all of their lives, and then towards the end of the journey, they go back and they repent and they come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is extremely happy with them coming back to Him, even after a long journey of mischief. That is who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. So we think well of Him. Yes, we still are cautious about our actions, and about sins and our errors, and we strive to do better and come back to Him in a better form and a better quality and a higher level of worship and a higher level of commitment, right? And more love and more humility. But at the end of the day, the Prophet ﷺ has always kept a smile on his face. And this is, we as Muslims ought to keep a smile on our face at all times. Unless, of course, somebody goes through, you know, some hardships or some loss of loved ones or some loss of health or what have you. It's perfectly okay to exercise the mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instilled in us and show some level of grief for a short period of time or whatever, you know, period of time that is necessary for us to vent these sad emotions out. Hada wallahu ta'ala a'la wa alam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one and the only one with the guidance and the mercy, to continue to bless us and guide us, to continue to cause us to live as Muslims, and never to take our souls except in a state of purity from sin. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to live so long that we live as Muslims and to die in a state of iman. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to resurrect us and join us with the prophets, the messengers, the martyrs, and the righteous. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُ بِحَمْدِكَ نَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ نَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَنَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ. سُبْحَانَ رَبِّكَ رَبِّ الْعِزَّةِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ وَسَلَامٌ عَلَى الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. جزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.